Good morning. We'll continue with our discussion on smart homes. In the last class, we have seen about some of the features of smart homes. Now, in today's class, we are going to see what are the technologies, potentials, and challenges for people with disabilities and elderly. For those, what are the features you have in smart homes that is going to be helping them in their day-to-day life? So we are going to see about this thing. So what is a smart home? The definition we have already seen. How do you build your smart home? And smartness, how it is good for you? If the people are going to have disabilities and elder, the people who are aged, how are they going to get benefit from the smartness which you are going to introduce into your home? How and why are they good for them? And what all points should we take care while we do it for the disabled people and elderly people, and possible technological challenges what you have in the future, and how you can personalize the technology for your house based on your requirement. So this is going to be the agenda of the today's lecture. So we are going to see the smart in the angle of two types of special people. One is people with disabilities and another one is people who are aged, or you call them as elderly people. So whatever we have seen yesterday is for a general smart home, what all appliances we can introduce the smartness and how it is going to work and what is the cost and other things we have seen. Today we are going to deal specific with elderly people and disabled people. So you know the definition of a smart home. So definition of a smart home is it is a house that has a highly advanced automated system for lighting, temperature control, multimedia security, window and door operations, and many other functions. So it is going to be automated for all these purposes. So it is going to use an advanced tracking mechanism, so which can handle the lighting depending on the people, temperature control. We have seen smart thermostat inside your air conditioner, so that is going to be temperature control. Then you have the multimedia security. We have seen about smart locks in the last class. So security, window and door applications, how to make your temperature, room temperature less by automatically, dynamically adjusting and closing the opening of your window. We have seen that and many other functions. So these are the basic functions which can be considered for your smart homes. So the basic functions are going to be lighting, temperature control, multimedia, security, window and door operations, and many other functions. So the next definition goes this way. A smart home or a building is a home or building, usually a new one, that is equipped with special structured wiring to enable occupants to remotely control or program an array of automated home electronic devices by entering a single command. So here they are not very specifically writing to what applications I am going to control. They are saying a variety of array of automated electronic device. So I'm going to have a lot of electronic appliances in my house. So I'm going to control them in a remote way through a single command. Okay, that depends on what programming language you use. So the basic point what they're trying to stress here is I'm going to control the appliances through a remote mechanism, and the house is going to be a new one. Or even your existing house, you can introduce the smart appliances, and the conventional wiring will not work because you have to interconnect all these sensors with a different type of wiring. So they say that it is a smart home. It's a new house which is equipped with special wiring to enable remote operation of all these electronic devices by using a single command. So next one is smart home. The same thing, you see a home equipped with lighting, heating and electronic devices that can be controlled remotely by smartphone or a computer. So the basic equipments can be controlled by a smartphone or a computer. So that is going to be the third definition of smart home. So how do you build a smart home? So you can either build it as a new building, because wireless has changed a lot. So the concept of wireless communication has changed the entire perspective of what all things can be done on the go, or you can augment an existing house with appropriate devices. Either they're completely a new house with new wiring and new devices you can completely build from the scratch, incorporate wireless technology, or an existing house using wire technology or wireless technology, you can introduce the smartness to the appropriate devices, whatever you are going to use. So there are two options available, and but if you're going to use wire communication, so completely wiring has to be changed, right? So that cannot be done in the existing house, because you have to break open the walls and you have to change the complete wiring. But if you are going to go for a new building, you can make it everything wireless. Okay, that is going to make your smart home even more faster. So the main components of a smart home, as we see, you are going to have a sensor, you are going to have a device, you are going to have a network, and you are going to have a control mechanism. A sensor, for example, I can have a sensor to detect the brightness of an LED. Okay, so depending on the brightness of the LED, depending on any person is there, I will change the brightness of the LED. So the sensor will detect the if any persons are there near the area. If persons are there, then the brightness will be increased. If persons are not there, the brightness will be decreased or the LED will be turned off. Next one, devices. So what all appliances you are going to introduce smartness? For example, smart washing machine. We have seen smart TV, smart LED, smart thermostat. So all these are going to be devices or appliances. So next one is network. How are these devices going to send and receive data? What mechanism or what medium they are going to use to send and receive? That is going to be the network. The networking part of it can be a wired network or wireless network. And finally, control panel mechanism. How we are going to control these devices from the remote place, how we are going to feed the information to all these sensors, and how we are going to receive the information which is going to be transmitted from all these sensors, the control mechanism. So which device should be turned on, which device should be turned off. So you can accordingly see what control mechanism should be in place to control all your devices. Okay, so these are considered to be the main components of a smart home. First one is sensors. The sensors are the devices which are going to sense any change in the parameter. Okay, devices where you are going to introduce smartness, networks, how are these sensors and devices going to communicate with the end user? And finally, the control panel mechanism, how we are going to display the information, how you are going to alarm, you are going to run an alarm, how you are going to run a buzzer, how you are going to create alert message to the user in this mobile phone, or you are going to send a WhatsApp ping. So depends on all these are going to be coming under the control panel mechanisms. So now sensor, we'll see about each one in detail. The sensors are going to be devices which are going to sense any physical parameter change. For example, a simple example, I would say you have an overhead tank in your house and you are having an automatic system to fill your tank. So the sensors will be fitted low and high. So if the water level goes below the low level, the sensors will automatically turn on the motor because they found that the water level is below the lowest level. So the water is now pouring into your overhead tank. Okay, now the water level has reached the high level. So after which, if the water is going to fall, the tank is going to overflow. The sensor has detected that if the water level is reached the maximum capacity, the sensor will alert the motor saying switch off the motor. The sensor is any device which detects some physical change. Here, the what example I said, the physical change is going to be the level of water. So if the water level is going below the lowest point, I will turn on my motor and fill the tank. If the water level is going to cross the highest point to avoid overflowing, I will turn off the motor so that the water level is always between the highest level and the lowest level. So you have several sensors, security system sensors, CCTV cameras, or infrared cameras. Those are security system sensors, occupancy motion sensors. So you can use the motion sensor to see if the area is occupied by people or if there people are there, so that you can accordingly turn on the lighting and fan accordingly. If a single person, you know how much air requires from the fan. So if there are multiple people, you can accordingly vary the speed of your fan and according to the lighting conditions in your room. And environmental sensors you can have to monitor the temperature of your house, temperature of a specific room you can monitor. If you are doing agriculture business, you can monitor the temperature of the soil, smoke, if any fire has happened, smoke sensor detect any smoke or fire, water leaks. So if water is leaking from the overhead tank or any of the appliances in our restroom or a washroom, we can detect the water leak sensor. Then weather sensor will ensure that the optimum temperature and other conditions are, humidity and other conditions are there, maintained inside our house. Accordingly, you can take remedial action to ensure that the house is livable to you. For example, if it is summer, you know it is going to be very hot outside. So what all sensors you can turn on so that you have minimal heat inside your house? So all these smartness you have to provide into the sensors. Next one, audio and video sensors. And then in case if the smart home finds that a person is lonely, automatically it plays the music, recording the video of people who are entering the house and leaving the house, CCTV camera footages, alerting the house by using a buzzer or alarm. All these are coming under the audio and video sensors. Okay, so all these come under audio and video sensors. Devices. So I told you sensors are going to detect some change. Devices are going to be the devices which are actually standalone, but you are going to introduce some intelligence into these devices. So devices are going to perform some activity or they are going to do some service to you. So you know refrigerator, we have seen smart refrigerator, you have microwave oven, dishwasher, laundry or a washing machine, I would say, vacuum cleaner, home cinemas, and finally TVs. Okay, so these things are the devices which are commonly used inside a house, which are purpose. So they are all having some specific purpose. You can see a refrigerator here. You can see a refrigerator here. You can see a microwave oven. You can see an oven. You can see a dishwasher here. You can see a dishwasher here. You can see a laundry mechanism here. You can see a washing machine here. You can see your home cinema, it is going to be LED speaker and your smart TV combined. You can have a home cinema. Individually also, you can have a TV or a vacuum cleaner and then other items. So these devices are going to be specific application based. How I am going to connect these devices and sensors? Okay, I can use Bluetooth. Bluetooth is for, I told you, it is only maximum high ideal range of Bluetooth 100 meters. But theoretically, the distance is not 100 meters. It is going to be less than 50 meters only for a Bluetooth because of the restrictions in the ideal environment. Infrared, you can use infrared. Is also for a very short distance, maximum of 10 meters. And one thing is infrared, if any obstacles are there, infrared will not work. The example I would say is the remote control. Any obstacle you place between the remote control and television, your IR will not work. IR requires your transmitter and receiver to be seeing each other. ZigBee, all these four different technologies are listed for long distance communication. ZigBee, Z-Wave, NFC, and Wi-Fi. Okay, so ZigBee, you know, it is a protocol. ZigBee's protocol for enhancing the range of your sensors. Okay, and Z-Wave, NFC, near field communication, Wi-Fi. Wi-Fi should be appropriate one for your house. If your house is a very big house, you can establish Wi-Fi hotspots at several places and you can connect all the devices using Wi-Fi. Okay, and what all the control panel or equipment you require a standalone personal computer, or you are going to have a tablet or a smartphone or a smart TV. You have any dedicated device for seeing and controlling all these devices, whether you have a robot or anything what we can interact with. They are not saying all the components should be available with you. No, you are going to decide which component you are going to use that is going to serve as a controlling device between yourself and the sensor. So it can be a standalone dedicated high speed, high memory capacity personal computer sitting in your house, but you know the PC cannot move. Unless you are in your house, you can view the data inside the PC, but once you are traveling, you cannot take the PC anywhere and go. So in that case, whether you are going to use a tablet or a smartphone or a TV, and dedicated device, whether you are going to have a separate GUI device for this functionality monitoring all the sensors and taking action, or whether you are going to have a standalone robo for deciding what course of action you have to take, and you have to program the robo also, and anything we can interact with, any other device you are going to use, you can use that for. It's going to act as a control between the devices and the end user. End user is going to be yourself. So what do we need from our home? Health, all we need to live in a healthy living environment. So first, the smart homes, they have to provide the purpose of smart home is to provide a healthy living environment, safety. So all we need to feel safe in our house. By having appropriate security systems, we should not all be always living with fear. So we should be convinced that the security system is going to be foolproof and it is going to help us live safely. Entertainment, all we need to get entertainment in our house. So smart TVs, other gadgets, what you have, they should provide the required entertainment. So as you spell out the movie should start playing in the TV. That can be a smartness which you are going to introduce to the smart TV. If you say, I want to play a particular movie, you just shout the name of the movie and say play. Automatically, the smart TV should capture your voice and it should decode what you have said, and it should search in YouTube or any other website, and it should start playing the name of the movie. That should be the entertainment aspect, what I'm saying. Communication and social participation. So friends and family are within the house. In smart TV, you can arrange the video conference meeting and you can meet all your relatives and family members virtually over the smart TV. In the video display, you can meet them. And you can also, I told you, smart TVs, you can browse the social networking website from the smart TV also. So any notification for any friends, you can that can be notified to you through the smart TV, and you can reply to them in a voice message like that. You need not type everything exclusively. Maybe by using a voice command or by showing some gestures, your smart device should be able to get the information what you're trying to convey, and you should take the appropriate action. Education, we all need to educate ourselves. So education has become online. The online mode of education has become popular during the pandemic times, right? So even when you are going to use online education, your smart TV should be helping you. Employability, so the work from home option is also becoming very popular now to reduce the cost. And another thing is considering the seriousness of the pandemic. So your smart TV has to equip or help you in this aspect also. Some of the smart home applications what are available nowadays, health services, I told you, remote aged people, their vital parameters have to be monitored very frequently, blood pressure, heart rate, temperature, so everything. So health services is main one predominant sector where the smart applications are used. And security, mainly security of your house, using smart locks, thermal cameras, IR cameras, CCTV cameras, using alarms, buzzers, and you can think of using fingerprint device to allow security, allow people inside like that. You can you improve the security of your house using all these features. Next one is monitoring services. Monitoring means monitoring some parameter, temperature, humidity, pressure. Maybe this you can use in agricultural field while you want to monitor the parameters of your soil. In your soil, you'll be monitoring the pH value, temperature, humidity, everything. And depending on the temperature and the other parameters, you will water the soil at a particular time. Then remote control. Yes, you can have a handheld remote control to operate equipment in case they do not respond. Energy resources controls how much energy you can generate. For example, yesterday we have seen about the renewable energy resources, right? How much, whether you can have a wind turbine above your house, you can have a solar panel. So how much you are generating, how much you are getting it from the electricity board, and how much you are saving. So that energy control can be made smart. Next one, plant watering, coffee making, pet feeding. See, plant watering, that you can automate it. So daily in this particular time, so for 10 minutes duration, I'm going to sprinkle water to my plant. Coffee making every day, I every day coffee. can program all these daily activities so that the smart appliance will remind you of all these things. And there is no application. You cannot say only these are the applications. They say sky is the limit, which means any smart application you develop will have its own purpose. What about persons with disabilities? We all need, yes, we have to design all our systems considering all the aspects of people. One aspect is going to be the normal people. Second one is persons with disabilities, whether they are, these smart features are going to help them or not. So what, how we are going to change your system to be, enable your devices to be smart for these people also. So whether what interaction you require between them and the system, what design change you have to do, what privacy it is going to have, and what are the applications. So whatever product you develop, it should be friendly for everybody. For example, disabled person should be able to use this. The aged persons must be able to use that. Normal persons must be able to use that. So the basic concept of working is going to be same, but you have to see where the specific changes are required for disabled people, aged people, and normal people. So that you have to decide. So applications for the persons with their disabilities. So these are the applications predominantly you can develop, keeping in mind these two types of people. First one is health services, as I said, the monitoring the vital parameters, monitoring their physical movements, whether they are able to walk on their own or they are able to walk with an assistance. So that you have to see notification and reminder. This one is for if they are consuming tablets, you can set a notification or reminder for them to consume the tablets. Safety and security, if they are alone, whether they are safe and secure. So you can monitor the status of the people by a remote place by using all the cameras and footages. Autonomy and mobility, whether they are able to do their task by themselves. Autonomy, whether they are able to take care of themselves, or if they are normal and taking care of themselves, okay. Otherwise, you have to see what can be done. Mobility, whether they can move with easiness, whether they can move independently or with the help of an assistant. So mobility is movement inside the house. Communication, how are they going to communicate in case of any emergency? And entertainment, what entertainment features we can provide for these two types of people, people with disability and people who are going to be elderly. Okay, all these can be the specific applications which you can develop for people with disability and the people who are going to have age. Technological challenges. What are technological challenges? We have fragmentation. Fragmentation means dividing into small information. So you will have a lot of appliances in your house. So the important thing is getting information from all these appliances and then communicating it effectively. So fragmentation is the first thing. Communication, collaboration. After communicating the values, how are you going to work as a single unit, collaborate and work as a single unit and do the action? Sustainability, whether it is okay for long term. For long term, if I'm going to use my smart home, it is going to be helpful or not. Survivability, in case of any environmental change, for example, it is raining heavily, it is going to be very hot. Whether in these situations, whether my devices are going to still withstand the environmental conditions and help in the smart home. And finally, energy. How much energy consumption they make, how much energy you produce. So energy what you produce and energy what you draw from the EP board. So that is going to be, the difference is going to be the energy savings. Okay, energy produced minus energy which is drawn from the EP board is going to be the energy which is going to be saved. I'm producing 20 kilowatt of energy. My consumption is 10 kilowatt. I'm going to save 10 kilowatt using a battery. Okay, so that you can reduce the dependence on the EP for your electricity consumption. Okay, some answers for all these problems what we have listed. So for fragmentation, you can use the devices as platforms. So the devices, for example, the smartphone, you have an app to control all the devices. So that is one answer. The simplest thing is using a smartphone to control all the devices. But again, elderly people and people with disability, they should be at least taught the minimum basic understanding of mobile phones so that they can control things on their own. Communication and what information is being shared between the devices and how it is disseminated to the other devices. So you will have standard protocols for communication, protocols, a set of rules which are set, which are agreed between the transmitter and the receiver. Okay, so standard protocols we are going to use for communication and collaboration. And you have several open source softwares like Android, Home OS, which can be used for app development. And that app can be installed in your smartphone. Then you can start using these apps to communicate or control your equipments. And human factor challenges. What are the human factor challenges? The design has to be properly done with the purpose, so that should not deviate its purpose. I mean, the temperature of the room has to be between, say, 30 and 35. So if it is exceeding 35, means the device should be designed in such a way that, or if it is exceeding 35, some action should be taken. So the design has to be perfect. Unless you don't perfect your design, the sensors will not work properly. And device survivability, I told you, some CCTV cameras, they will be in open space, right? So in case of rainy season, whether the rain is going to affect the working of the camera. And the roof temperature you are going to measure, you will have a sensor at the roof. In case if it is going to be a high temperature in the summer, or in case if it is going to rain heavily, in Western countries, you have the concept of snow also, right? So in case if snow is going to cover all these sensors, whether the sensors are going to work or not. So you have to consider all the points. Ease of use or interaction. So how we are able to understand the working of all these sensors and how we are going to interact with the sensors using the app. Unobtrusiveness. No, it is not going to affect the natural working. Okay. Ambient privacy issues. All these mean that. So, you know, everybody has their own privacy issues. So these sensors and applications should not intrude into your privacy. At any cost, the privacy has to be observed. So these are the challenges you have when you are going to build smart home-based sensors. Okay, so these are the things you have to consider when you are going to build the application for smart home. So we should place people in the first place, and we should develop, and the priority must be given for people, and privacy must be respected, and we must develop app, or we must develop the smart home or things which should be designed and developed for all types of people. So nowadays, disabled people, they will not be able to walk into a normal house which is going to have footsteps. So there should be provision for ramp, right? So all these features have to be considered for all the people. Okay, that is what they are meaning. The opportunities not to be missed. So new sensors are available, wearable sensors are available. So in case if you are able to procure the wearable sensors, you will be having sensors like a watch. So you can wear the watch, that watch will be capturing your heart rate, temperature, pressure, everything, and it will be sending the information periodically. It is just like you are wearing a watch. So electronics has become so advanced that the wearable technology is taking over everything, and you can wear the sensors around your body just like a watch. New interaction techniques, so new protocols, new communication devices, they have all come. So that is going to make your job easy. Effective computing, only when some change is observed, I am going to react. Otherwise, I am going to remain silent. Okay, so I'm going to be on all the time, but I'm going to react only when there is some change, or only when the change is required, I'm going to communicate. Ubiquitous means real time. So I'm going to compute everything on a real time basis. So I don't, I have to be active all the time, and I have to be live. So all data has to be live. So you cannot rely on past data. Okay, all data has to be live. Next one, cloud computing. All the data what is captured with the devices will be stored in the cloud, and you can retrieve them later also for any referencing or cross check. And even by using the past data, you can predict what can happen in the future. That can also be done. Big data. This is going to be a big data. Predicting with the past values what could be the future. So you are using a sensor for the past 1 month, so the 1 month data is available to the sensor. Now what a sensor will do with the 1 month's data, it will predict what can be the temperature for tomorrow. the prediction might be correct or might not be correct. That it's not bothered, but that facility or feature is also available currently in all the sensors. So big data means analyzing the data and transforming the data as you like. So putting all people in the first place, first thing should be the people and not the sensors. So the people have to be thing you do, any invention or any discovery you do, the people have to be put first in the thing. Okay, we already have device and sensors. We already have all the applications. We are learning the user needs of different types of users, and we map appropriate applications or devices for each group of people. So now we need to know machines to know their users and adapt accordingly. So we have to provide that intelligence to users. So the machine should know that the people in the room are disabled people. So accordingly, it should offer services to them. Or the machine should be able to identify the people accordingly and provide service. That intelligence has to be provided to the sensors and devices. So all the people have to be prioritized first, then it's going to be the sensors. Personalization or adaptation. So we need data about the device and application. First thing, you need to list out the devices, what you are going to introduce as a part of your smart house, and you should know the application. You should know the working of the device. You should know what application is going to be used and how we are going to make the device work. So we need data about users and their needs. So different users will have a different, for example, people who are really old, they cannot withstand cold temperature, and people naturally young, they can withstand cold temperature. So depending on the data of the users, their needs have to be taken care of. So the working should not be same for all the users, which is not going to work. So we need data about other contextual parameters. So specific, any user specific data also has to be fed, so that the sensor should clearly know for whom it is working, either for normal people or the disabled people or the aged people or the young generation people. So combining all these semantic technologies could lead to better personalization and adaptation of smart home applications. So generally, smart home is a generic thing. So you fix the sensors, you track them, you control them. But the sensors can be made to identify for whom it is going to be done. That is the biggest advantage of running a smart home. Okay, the existing approaches, you have all these method composite capabilities, preferences. You create a profile person, and accordingly you derive different functions for the different people. Okay, so next one is universal remote control. You have that, you have that feature. These are the existing technical features. You can go to this and check if you're interested. Extensible multimodal annotation markup language, just like HTML and XML, you have EMMA. It is called the extensible multimodal annotation markup language. So these are the different standards by which communication can happen. Next one is IMS access for all personal needs and preferences description for digital delivery information model and ACMD. Okay, that is what is given here. And last one, individualized adaptability and accessibility in e-learning, education, and training. So you can use all these modules and see where you can bring the difference in your application. So what about context modeling? So when you are going to model, where you are going to model, where means inside your house, when means what frequent timings you are going to model it. Context means how we are going to predict a particular parameter, and you're going to control it. So when I'm going to model, the time frame you have to see. Temperature, I'm going to monitor always, means it is going to be done every second. Where means whether in my entire house or a part of the house, you have to decide what do you want to do. After measuring the temperature, what should I do? Depending if the temperature is high, what should I do? The temperature is low, what should I do? What action I should take? How I should take? So if the temperature is very high, means I will lower the windows automatically so that the outside heat does not get into my house. If the temperature is very cold, slightly I will increase the height of the window so that there is some heat inside the house to overcome the cold. And in the when the visibility is poor, you want more light to enter. So you will turn on the, you will try to bring up the height of the window. But if it is going to be in the evening and night, you cannot do that because you don't have light inside, right? So in that case, what you do, you increase the brightness of the LEDs in your house. So everything has to be dynamically done depending on the situation. other environmental parameters like sound and lightning, depending on the people. Elderly people, they don't they the sound the sound appears to be noise to them, so they require only mild sound. So that has to be taken care. And lighting also, it should not be so much bright. So it has to be depending on the persons who are available there. Who else is there? Whether all the age group people are there. Anything else means any other sensor or devices working there. So what about the social context modeling? So rather than the smart device modeling, nowadays this social context modeling is also taking a bigger role. Social context means the devices need to know who are all there inside the house and what is the need of each person. I want the fan to run very fast. My father wants the fans to run at a medium speed. My elderly people want the fan to run in a lower speed. So you have to. The devices have to adjust accordingly. So who is in the house? So you should know who is residing in the house. What are their needs? Everybody's needs are not going to be the same. How do we relate them? Can we have a common mechanism to address all these things? Is that possible? Do we trust them? Really, is the devices working based on the needs of the person? When I go near the sensor, is the speed fast? Speed of the fan is fast. When the elderly person is nearing the fan, the speed is getting lower. So are all these really happening? Is the system working really well? Do you feel comfortable with the system? Who is in command or superior position? Who is going to do all these things? So who is going to incorporate intelligence into all these devices? Naturally, we are going to program everything and ensure that it is going to vary, the response is going to vary from person to person. What about cultural background modeling? So does cultural background affect interaction? So when some guest comes to your house, so they might be living in some other area and their response is going to be different. So am I going to model that also? These six members in your house means you will be creating a profile for six members, and accordingly the devices will be tuned to that. If people outside are going to come, are you going to include that also? So what is the cultural background of those new users? So for them, is the existing thing is okay? So what feels better or normal for them in their interaction? So are they comfortable with the existing parameters of the sensors, or something has to be changed? What happens when users move with different cultural background with the same environment? So people who live in hill stations, they will not have seen the concept of heat. Temperature would be, they would like the temperature to be less. But when the temperature is very, very high, they won't feel it normal, right? So they will feel something abnormal. So for that also, are we prepared to adjust our sensors? The first one, rather than the social context modeling, we also have to think about cultural background modeling also. This is going to be a serious research problem. So investigate all possible technology standards and models that could be used for both social context and cultural background modeling. If you do that, it will be a pakka smart home system for anybody. And these are the things maybe you can have a look at it for getting a better understanding. For the reading, you can definitely go at these articles and see how the smartness is introduced in each of the following devices. So that is all we have for today. And this unit has three components. One is smart homes, which we've completed. Next one is security in smart homes. And the third topic is going to be the sensors which we are going to use in the smart home. We are going to see about the sensors in depth, which we are going to see use in our smart home. So that is how this unit